Our speaker today is Marilynne Eichinger, the Executive Director of Oregon Museum of Science and Industry. I was about to say the new Executive Director when I realized that she's been here for almost a year, and people have different conceptions of newness. Some of us who remember when OMSI moved into its present building, and to whom the present building still seems new, were a bit startled recently to read that OMSI is now looking for an even newer location. OMSI's been much in the news lately because of the current dinosaur exhibit and the recent exhibit of arts and crafts from India. But in addition to such spectacular features, OMSI performs the steady, day-to-day function of educating the public, and particularly school children, about science and technology in the modern world. In this, it has attained national recognition. And under Marilynne Eichinger's leadership, it seems that OMSI's great reputation will be even more enhanced. Ms. Eichinger received her undergraduate degree from Boston University and her master's degree from Michigan State University. In East Lansing, Michigan, she initiated and implemented the idea for an interactive science and art museum and served as its president and executive director for some 12 years. From Michigan, she came to us last fall after a nationwide search by the OMSI board. She showed her good judgment by joining the City Club shortly after she arrived. Her vision and energy have not only produced some outstanding exhibits, but they have resulted in the opening of a branch at the Lloyd Center and the present search for a new location for OMSI's main facility. We are eager to hear her thoughts on science and education for tomorrow. Ms. Eichinger.
I really have been looking forward to being here and speaking to you today. When I was first asked to speak to you, I was suggested that I talk about my experiences as a woman who was a director of a science museum. That's not my favorite topic. But as a matter of information, I was the first woman to be the director of a science museum in the United States. Today there are 12 women who are directors of there are 170 science museums in the United States. Quite frankly, I never realized that I was in a unique position. I was a very determined individual who perceived a serious community need, and I led my organization by tuning into what appeared to be the unique conditions of the community, and by taking advantage of every and any opportunity that appeared before me. I remember, for instance, when I was starting as founder and director of Impression 5, and things weren't going very well. I had visited dignitaries throughout the community, and I couldn't seem to get my idea across about what I wanted to do with an interactive science and technology center. But I'll never forget one man in particular. He was the director of the YMCA, and he told me that I never would get my idea off the ground, because in Lansing there were only two things that were important. One was sports, and the other was sex, and I wasn't promoting either of them. Well, sitting in my office one day, while wondering what I was going to do to have people take my ideas seriously, I remembered reading somewhere that the Playboy Bunnies help nonprofit organizations raise money by playing sporting events. So, sure enough, I called up the Detroit Playboy Club, and the women were willing to visit Lansing and to play basketball against the community celebrities. To put the celebrity team together, I called every business, education, and government leader, all of whom were men at the time, and asked them to play. There wasn't a single person who turned me down. Well, the papers got a hold of the idea, as did the area women's lib groups, unfortunately. It was the height of the women's movement, and some women threatened to organize a picket. The men on the celebrity team were harassed and asked to resign. So in reaction, I thought, and I brought the board on board the Michigan State women's basketball team. And they played practice sessions against our community celebrities, outlasting them. The men had to change every 2 minutes while the women played the whole game. Still, the picketers threatened. No one wanted to back out, yet all were reluctant to play. Well, believe it or not, this is one of these instances that Mother Nature saved the day. The night before the game, Lansing experienced a 50-year flood, and the field house was underwater for 1 foot. One foot of water was in the field house. The whole town was out bagging the next day. The game never did occur, but due to the publicity and the commitment by the celebrities, the museum was launched. Well, what did I... Well, what did I learn from that lesson? Well, good things sometimes have very strange beginnings. And you have to listen to your community's values and take advantage of opportunity. And quite frankly, I'm really glad to be living now in Portland, a community that's looking to the future and understands some education values. We're in a very new era. It's a time of rapid change. There are lots of buzzwords that we hear, like computer networks and biotechnology and artificial intelligence and fiber optics and power grids. We're watching organizational changes affected by automation, resulting in decreasing workforces and increasing employee involvement through quality of work circles, employee ownership of companies, and union management relationships that are changing. It's a time of businesses that are on top of the ladder one day and at the bottom the next. We're watching the space program with fascination. We're ready to support it one moment and ready to throw it away the next. I think that's very interesting when you consider that there are companies like the Society Expedition Company that is now planning to send launch people who are just lay people into space for a small fee of $50,000 in 1992. What they are finding is that their first two space shuttle missions are filled up. So if you want to go into space, you better get your money in now. There are those who are watching Russia and see that a space station is being assembled right now on the ground. And they're predicting that when it's launched, it's going to cause new Sputnik-like activities in this country. And we watch children play with space toys, going to space camps, studying space curriculum in schools, and in general, preparing for this new frontier. I think, personally, that it's a rather exciting time to be alive, especially if you're prepared for increasingly rapid change. Of course, if you're not prepared, well, there's the state welfare system, or charity, or you could become a bag man or a bag woman. You might turn to drink, or burn down the house, or as many Portlanders are doing, you might turn to burglary. It seems to be a growing Oregon industry. Well, about 12 years ago, I became concerned about the picture I just painted for you. I worked in an emergency center of a mental health institute and watched people coming in because they did not have job skills or the mental attitude for dealing with the society of rapid change. They became a divorce statistic, a wife and child abuse statistic, and on the unemployment rolls. They were people who had lost their ability to make decisions about their lives. They certainly were not able to make decisions about the complex societal issues that face our country as a result of technology. I started realizing then that we needed educational institutions that helped prepare people for the challenge of the 21st century. And I became then involved in Michigan starting a science center. To me, the Science Museum was a center that could help people stay abreast of change and teach them how to make decisions in a country that permits so much freedom. It's a center that the whole family can enjoy, where children involve their parents in some of the new scientific concepts that they're learning in school. And adults can educate their own children using the self-learning devices found in interactive museums. It's very interesting to watch a family in the museum Children don't want to read, but they'll become involved. The parents, in the meantime, they want to read everything, and they'll explain things to their children. It's a place of bright lights, of color and excitement, filled with highly structured yet flexible activities. It's to the science museums that I looked for the new education institution of the next era. I see in the scientific process of formulating a hypothesis, developing a conclusion, only to restate that hypothesis and start the whole process over again, a basic model for decision making. Exhibits that use the scientific method are able to inspire people to learn, think, and make choices. It is to the science museum that children are going, and children as well as adults can keep abreast of new science and technology. The science museum is a family institution, a place to go when it rains, and we all know it rains here, and we need that kind of indoor family institution, and a shared entertainment facility. But the schools also need us. All of us are watching how difficult it is to pass a tax levy for schools. Personally, and I'm able to say this because I'm not a politician, I think it's just terrible that in this state, taxes aren't passed. What community are we that does not protect, nurture, and educate our young to the very best of our ability? However, it may be that new forms of educational institutions are necessary for the next era. Perhaps we don't believe the present systems work, and maybe that's why we're not passing these tax levies. Even when funding is available, is it possible to have every single school equipped with lasers and electron microscopes and computer-aided design capability and robots? We need a community center where all schools can visit to conduct their programs and learn about new technology. Our museum's job becomes one of providing exciting educational material, of maintaining it, and that maintenance is very important because if you look at schools, one of the biggest problems they have is they have no one to maintain the equipment that they put in their back closets. And we also have the job of helping visitors to have access to this equipment. To our community, we must become an integral part of the education system. And it must not cost our children too much. Quite frankly, OMSI's fees right now are too high. It costs $7 for every person who comes through the door of OMSI. We have to charge. There isn't any tax support. Is it time for a change for that, too? Should everyone pay a small amount so that no one has to pay too much? But even more than education, science is fun. The public has even found it to be entertaining. Programs on television such as Nova and National Geographic are having record viewing audiences. The public buys magazines such as Omni and Science 86 and Discover magazine and computing magazines. Nationally, they're flocking to science centers. Did you know that science museums are only 8% of the museums in the United States, but they're getting 48% of all attendance to museums? That's a tremendous number of people. Internationally, science centers are being constructed as major tourist attractions. The goal is to keep a visitor 4 to 5 hours by providing exhibits, science films, and snacks. As a result, those visiting on conventions will bring their families. The conventioneer or tourist will stay in town one extra night, sleeping at area hotels and eating in our restaurants. And conventions also provide a little extra business for science centers. Between the hours of 5 and 9, what better place is there to have a cocktail party? Businesses right now can rent OMSI, and it's often used for Christmas parties or sales parties, and believe it or not, a good use is political fundraisers. OMSI is ready to take on its role as an institution for this era. It has reached a turning point in its history. It's absolutely bursting at the seams. An institution that was built for 100,000 people is now, last year, served over 550,000 people, We just got those statistics. And we had that attendance even though we were closed this year for 2.5 months. A building that was meant to hold 40 staff members now houses 126 staff members. There were many occasions when between 200 and 300 people wishing to attend our lectures this year, they were turned away at our door, and they went away angry. Overcrowding is a constant complaint, as is our access to parking. Storage is just impossible and inaccessible. Teachers have no preparation room and sometimes wind up trying to put a class together in the hallways because the rooms are all being used. OMSI is planning as a result to grow. The recent interest in large traveling exhibits such as India or the dinosaurs creates chaos of its own. The museum exhibit floor is so small that it's necessary to take out our regular science exhibits and either warehouse them or set them up in an auxiliary museum. The one at Lloyd Center has been set up and is very popular, but it creates its own problems. It creates a staff with a split focus and added expenses that could not be supported without the kindness of foundations like the Fred Meyer Trust, who gave us $100,000 to set up the Lloyd Center OMSI 2, and the Lloyd Corporation, who has given us free rent. Science teachers planning to integrate the museum in their class curriculum can't depend on OMSI because, as I said, we were closed 2.5 months this year, and a lot of our science exhibits aren't there. They're either at the Lloyd Center or they're in storage. Tourism is also negatively impacted because there have been days when 600-700 people have been to our door when we've been closed. OMSI is planning to grow. In general, OMSI's overcrowded conditions are producing both angry visitors and disgruntled staff. Members have to wait in long lines to get in. You should see what it looks like today outside of OMSI. There are very long lines. Teachers can't plan in advance. Visitors can't find parking. And tourists face weeks of closed signs. OMSI is planning, as I said, to grow. Portland is a growing and attractive community that is starting to take its place as an international city. I just heard about something that was very interesting, that it's going to be featured in National Geographic in an article on city skylines. Major plans are underway for a convention center and new hotels, and there's talk of other tourist attractions such as an aquarium. An active convention association is attracting an ever-growing number of visitors to this area. A concern for architecture, for public sculpture, and clean air, those qualities are the qualities that brought me to this city, and this concern will have an effect on future growth. Growth in Portland, from what I see, is done well. And with planning and a lot of foresight, I don't think growth in this city is anything to be afraid of. OMSI can also provide a benefit to the city and local economy by becoming a major tourist attraction. Departing slightly from its original mission to serve many local residents, the museum should add as a goal that of attracting a greater number of out-of-town visitors. To do so means that OMSI must become what I call an endpoint destination with the capability of keeping visitors for 4 to 5 hours. That means that an adequate IMAX and OmniMax theater, we're talking about that, restaurant, exhibit halls, labs, demonstration sites must be developed. More fanciful exhibits that create a playful atmosphere can be infused in a new facility. We're finding this summer that people like the dinosaurs because it has a Disney-like, a Disney World atmosphere to it, and it's a fun attraction to learning. Exhibits that deal with subjects such as space exploration, genetic engineering, communication, as well as the basics will challenge the curious. As a result, tourists will stay overnight and spouses will accompany their husbands or wives during conventions. A recent museum study of cultural institutions that was done in Philadelphia estimated that a museum that attracts 25 people a day to view its exhibits brings the same income into a community as a new business with a payroll of $125,000. An additional 100 out-of-town visitors per day would generate 111 industry-related jobs. My staff, the board, and I are in the process of developing what we believe that this intelligent community and a magnificent community should have. We, in the last 5 months, we have been laying the seeds for our growth. We have developed a complete new organization plan for our present building that is the basic of our expanded OMSI. Each new exhibit floor plan that we are working on now, when we bring the museum back to back in September, is the core of our new exhibit ideas for a new OMSI. The exhibits will concentrate on the basic sciences that lead to sophisticated technology and will be presented in a Disney World fashion that's fun and exciting. The entire museum will become an interactive science lab, so you can actually get your hands on science and become involved in doing rather than observing. Even now, we're starting to open up more of the museum. We're making classrooms on the lower level into labs that are open to the public. They're going to be open several hours a day when they're not used for classroom space, so that the random visitor who wants to try simple experiments with the aid of a facilitator can do so. The classroom labs will be a little more informal than the main floor exhibits and invite personal interaction with our trained specialists. In order to get our dream off the ground, OMSI has just hired the firm of Zimmer, Gunsel, and Frasca to assist in the final selection of a site and the initial design planning for our new facility. Four sites are being studied in some depth right now. Our own site, the Union Station, Terminal 1 site on the west side of the river near the Fremont Bridge, and the Station L site, which is on the east side of the river right near the Markham Bridge. OMSI right now is experiencing a renaissance. Large visitor audiences tell us that people are interested in what we're doing. With an improved museum format and the continued policy of attracting traveling exhibits, we anticipate the interest in OMSI to continue to grow. Now is our time, for the community is getting behind OMSI. We're very, very serious about our need to grow. Quite frankly, I believe that OMSI cannot survive if it doesn't grow. Public demand is wearing out the old OMSI. OMSI's loved. It has 91% name identification, and 48% of all Portlanders have visited OMSI, and that's a very high percentage. And so, we'll meet the public's need and answer its call for an institution for the next decade. An institution that knows no boundaries of East and West Side, one that attracts visitors from throughout the Northwest. It is to this exciting challenge that I have dedicated myself for the next few years. And I am sure with your help that we're going to succeed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Marilynne Eichinger. You presented an exciting prospect and certainly given us a lot to think about. We now have time for questions, and the privilege of asking the first question goes to our board host, Dick Hutchinson.
Marilynne, I've been visiting OMSI all of my life and have a strong interest in science because of it. I give it credit for that. Could you tell us what sources of funds will OMSI pursue to implement plans for its growth and expansion? Will you consider public revenue sources?
I'll give you a good political wishy-washy answer on that one. Probably yes, everything. I don't know yet. We don't know exactly how much money this is going to all cost. We suspect it's going to be in the neighborhood of $20 million. We were very fortunate to have Howard Vollum give us a bequest to start the project out. We have $3 million to start building the new OMSI. Howard Vollum, by the way, was very involved in OMSI. He was a wonderful man. He used to come into our labs in the research center and give up his own time till 1-2 o'clock in the morning and help young children with their science projects. We will determine that when we have our package together.
Why don't you just go ahead and take the questions yourself without my interrupting?
I'd like to pass, Dave Olson, City Club, I'd like to pass along an idea from a friend of Jack Murdoch's, Howard Vollum's partner. And he sees a need in this city for a science electronics museum, you know, that could begin with Howard Vollum's first oscilloscope and just expand from there.
Thank you. I agree with you. One of the exhibit halls in the new museum is going to be an exhibit hall we call Information Sciences. And in that exhibit hall, we're talking not only about computer-aided design and artificial intelligence and robotics communication, but electronics. And right now, in fact, we're trying to raise about $60,000 to put more electronics exhibits, simple electronics exhibits, on the floor of our present museum. And I agree, that's very important. All of us, even those who are not in the field, have to deal with the electronics repairman. And it's important for us to know what that person's talking about.
My name is Adam Hans with the City Club. I was interested in your comments about space exploration and the shuttle disaster. What are your own personal feelings on that whole issue? You know, we spend so much money, at least to date we have, in space exploration. There are other pressing needs here on Earth, yet, you know, exploring the stars is very exciting and has great potential. Where do you think our priorities ought to be placed in this area?
Well, I think that when people were coming west, they came. And fortunately, unfortunately, I think that there's a push and a desire to explore the new frontier. And I think we're going to go one way or another. If it's not our country, it's going to be another country. Russia, as I mentioned, is right now exploring space. There are lots of fascinating things that we're learning about space. We think that there's going to be a lot of benefits. Right now, there have been a lot of benefits from the space program to Earth, life on Earth. We don't know where it's going to take us, but we're a curious people. We're very curious, and we're challenged. And I'm sure that we're going to go on with space exploration. In the fall, the U.S. space camps, which started in Huntsville, Alabama, and the U.S. space camps are not run by the government. It's just a very clever name that somebody put together to attract funding, and they're doing very well. But they're coming out with a movie. And the space camp is a camp for young children, although now they're starting to open it up for adults because adults are interested too. But it's the kind of program where it teaches you to live and work in space. They're getting 500 requests a day for people to go to the space camp. When the movie comes out, we don't know how many requests that's going to go to. We're right now planning what we call the Pacific Rim Space Education Center. That's one of the exhibit halls in OMSI. And in fact, next summer, we're going to be starting to have our own space camp at OMSI.
Dick, do you want to go ahead?
Oh, go ahead.
Excuse me. My name is Len Bergstein. Marilyn, could you describe in greater detail the relationship between OMSI and the Portland school system or some of the other school districts, what kinds of programs you have on the drawing board?
Okay. I mentioned that there were a lot of problems with OMSI right now. It's OMSI's fault. We don't have a lot of basic science in the museum. We're putting it back into the museum. We also have been taking so many displays out that the schools can't depend on us. And when a teacher is preparing curriculum for the classroom and wants to integrate a field trip into the classroom situation, that teacher plans a year in advance. And they expect those exhibits to be there. And that way, they can have a laboratory type of experience when they come to the museum. But if we're not providing that laboratory experience, they can't come. And that's what's been happening to OMSI. Quite frankly, our school attendance has gone down because of that. However, one thing that has gone up is our outreach program. Last year, we served 50,000 people outside of the museum, and we have gone into schools all over the state, and we've developed all sorts of programs for teachers, programs for children in auditoriums. We even go into shopping centers around the state, and are developing such an extensive interest in that program that we have split one of our departments off, and we're anticipating that next year and the next 2 years, we're going to have 100,000 people served in outreach programming. So what we're trying to do with the schools is start to put some things back in the present OMSI that will be there all the time for the teachers so that they can use it in a better way.
Barbara Clark, City Club. I like science, and I've been to Disneyland, and to me, they're not quite comparable experiences. And do you think it's fair to raise the expectation that science will be as exciting as Disneyland?
It's a technique. It's a trick. And people come in not because of science. In fact, many people have told me they don't like the name the Oregon Museum of Science and Industry. That name creates a barrier. But they like the name of OMSI because it's friendly. And again, it's a nice handle. It's a nice inviting type of name. So I feel that part of the Disney World techniques, for instance, with our dinosaurs, attracts the public. But then what we have around the dinosaurs is all sorts of interactive, highly educational material that people become involved in, so they do start learning. And I think that combination works very, very well hand in hand.
Dan Goldie, City Club. Marilynne, with respect to the degree to which OMSI can become a regional tourist attraction, why are we competing with any comparable facilities in Seattle, Boise, or Northern California? How unique is OMSI?
As I mentioned, that there are 170 science museums in the United States today. They're growing very rapidly. There is the Pacific Science Center in Seattle. It's not a competition. Actually, people who tend to go to one science museum are the same people who tend to go to another. So it will be a help to us. What we're going to do is develop a Portland type of science museum. We won't duplicate their exhibits. And I'm sure that we will become a major attraction so that people from Seattle will come here. And there's no doubt in my mind. Boise doesn't yet have a science museum. I have been asked to be a consultant to Boise, however. They're interested in starting a small science center, but I don't think it's going to be on the same scale that we're talking about. We're small. At one time, we were large in terms of science museums. We were one of the founding organizations to start the Association of Science and Technology Centers. They're talking about kicking us out as a major institution now, because we're too small, which is very, very surprising. But our city can support a larger institution.
Louise Questad, City Club member. What are your plans for Camp Hancock?
Camp Hancock continues to offer very excellent programs. We have added two other camps. We have Quantilog and Kaleidoscope camps on the coast and in the mountains. Our plans are just to continue Camp Hancock and have the offerings go for more weeks of the year. One of the problems is that the housing is not insulated. So we took advantage this year of the Rajneeshpuram. And when they had their big sales, we went out and we bought 6 A-frame houses from them from all of $600. And they are insulated. So now we can have programming for more months of the year.
I'm curious to know whether or not OMSI and the other such museums have an interchange network such as art museums and the like. The Smithsonian Foundation has superb material available in Washington, D.C., and very few of us get to Washington, particularly with our children. Mm-hmm. Is there a program?
That's an excellent question. I'm so glad you asked it. A number of things. Let me start out with something that I put together. I put it together when I was in Michigan, and we have a collaborative, and it just happened that OMSI was a member of this collaborative. So we have a collaborative of 8 museums nationally. Boston Science Museum is involved, and a museum in Charlotte, and Louisville, Kentucky, and San Diego, and the Pacific Science Center, and so on. These museums all receive money from National Science Foundation. I received a $1.2 million grant. And that money is divided up so that each museum is making an exhibit that will tour to the other sites. So that's one example. The Association of Science and Technology Centers also gets ideas from museums and some of their displays and has them travel. We are now have been asked to reproduce one of our exhibits, an exhibit called Millions, that's going to travel around the United States for the next few years, next 3 years. So there is that kind of network, and we hope to bring more exhibits in. Last thing I'd like to mention is competition, however. The good exhibits, the really good ones, are hard to get. India was our first international display. It only went to 6 different cities. And it went to Chicago and then Los Angeles and then it came to us. It's hard to be one of the museums to attract that type of thing, and you need to have a large facility and not have to close your museum down every time if you want to attract an international display. We want to be able to do that.
Dennis Cusack, City Club. I'm curious about the criteria for your new site selection. I'm thinking about the relationship to the urban core, the waterfront, public transportation.
All right, let me mention one of the reasons we're even talking about leaving our present site. Some people, I'm sure, wonder why we even talk that way. In 1967, I believe it was, the city came in and put in a nice highway and undercut the hill that we're on. And the building started to slip down the hill. Well, with more weight on that hill, there's a possibility that that slippage will continue. We keep monitoring, even now, the cracks in the building. Then there's not that much land that you can actually build on that site. The other problem we're having is one of parking. In order to be a facility that holds people for 4 to 5 hours, we expect those cars, of course, to be sitting in the parking lot for 4 to 5 hours. Well, that means that we have to have a 1,000-car parking ramp of some sort for ourselves. That would cost about $10 million. So to stay in that present location is extremely expensive. We started looking at other sites. We started going to Gresham, we went to Clackamas County and Beaverton, and we wondered whether we should go to another park-like atmosphere, a place where there'd be a lot of land, so that we could think not only of today, but of tomorrow and our future growth. But we decided instead that Portland, and in fact all of Oregon, does not have an indoor museum or tourist facility, entertainment facility. We don't have one in the whole state. And we thought that it would be smart to stay near the population density. So one of the things we decided is to stay in the core and look at sites that were near the downtown area. We want them to be accessible to both sides of the river. And river sites are very romantic. You can do a lot of things on the river. So there's some intrigue with that. If we're going from a beautiful site, we want to go to another one that's attractive. Well, I thank you very much.
We certainly thank you. We certainly thank you, Marilynne, and we wish you all kinds of success in your new projects. We are adjourned. Remember, next week it's TriMat here in the room. That was very well done. Enjoyed it so much.
Thank you.
This program was sponsored by Portland General Electric Company.